In this video, we are going to discuss about the special regions of peritoneal cavity. So in that, we are going to discuss about the five topics. One is subphrenic spaces, or also called as supracolic compartment, and next comes a hepatorenal pouch or Morrison's pouch along with its clinical anatomy. Next comes infracolic compartment, next comes the paracolic glottis and the rectouterine pouch, or called as pouch of Douglas. So this is the orientation of this video. So first let us start with subphrenic spaces. Okay, so what are subphrenic spaces? For this we need to draw this diagram. So first you have liver here, okay, and next you have here you have your stomach, okay, and you know this is esophagus, part of stomach, this is duodenum, and here comes your ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon. Okay, so actually the transverse colon acts as a landmark here. Why? Because this transverse, on the basis of this transverse colon, we divide this part above the transverse colon into supracolic region and below transverse colon region into infracolic region. And you know, back of this ascending colon, you have a mesentery. Okay. And these are first mentioned, which is right side and left side. This is the left side and this is the right side. So this is a right paracolic gutter. This is of course on left side. Okay. And here comes actually the supracolic region have three spaces. One is subphrenic. Here you'll have diaphragm. Okay. This is diaphragm. So remember, in supracolic you'll have three spaces. So what are this? One is subphrenic, one is subhepatic, one is hepatorenal pouch. Actually hepatorenal pouch, you can say the subhepatic or hepatorenal pouch, both are same. So you can say there are two spaces in the supracolic space. Okay, and in infracolic space we need to discuss about the paracolic glottis, that's it. And also we need to discuss about here you have pelvic cavity, right? So you have one pouch, that is the recto uterine pouch, okay, also called as pouch of Douglas. I already routed here. So let us start one by one. So first we'll start with subphrenic, subhepatic. So according to the name, very simple, this is diaphragm. So below it, this is called as the space, this is liver, right? Upon liver, this space is called as subphrenic space. And this subphrenic space is actually divided into right subphrenic space here and here left subphrenic space. Okay, and below you'll have left subhepatic, because below liver subhepatic, here you'll have right subhepatic space. Okay, so actually this regions are mainly, this supracolic region is divided into two parts. One is intraperitoneal region, one is extraperitoneal. So what are the spaces which are present intraperitoneal, what are present extraperitoneal, we'll discuss. Extraperitoneal space is nothing but, for example, this all organs are covered by peritoneum, so they are intraperitoneal. The organs which are outside this peritoneum, this is extraperitoneum, so this is right side. So right extraperitoneal and this is left extraperitoneal. Okay, so what are intraperitoneal spaces? You have subphrenic, subhepatic, both are intraperitoneal spaces. They are divided mainly into four types, like right anterior, right posterior. So this is right anterior, this is right posterior. Okay, right anterior space refers to right subphrenic space, right posterior refers to right subhepatic space. Okay, left anterior space refers to left subphrenic space, left posterior refers to left subhepatic space. So let me write them, you'll understand, right? So these are what all? Intraperitoneal spaces, intraperitoneal spaces. Okay, they are divided into right anterior and right posterior left anterior and left posterior. So what is right anterior space? That is right subphrenic. Phrenic means below diaphragm. Okay, right subphrenic space. So what is right posterior? That is right subhepatic here. Okay, right subhepatic space. So let me show them in diagram. So anterior, right side, right subphrenic, right side posterior, right subhepatic space. Okay, next coming to left side. Left side anterior, again same, left subphrenic here, and here posterior, left subhepatic, right. So what you need to remember, either in right side or left side, anterior refers to phrenic, posterior refers to hepatic. Okay, that's it. So like this, you have completed the supracolic region. So supracolonic region, you understood what is subphrenic space, supracolic compartment. Next, you understood what is hepatorenal pouch. Hepatorenal pouch is nothing but also called as right posterior compartment, that is nothing but subhepatic, right subhepatic space, which is hepatorenal pouch, also called Morrison's pouch. We should also discuss its clinical anatomy. Now let us discuss about this relations also, like boundaries, what are present anteriorly, posteriorly. So here lies the hepatorenal pouch, right? So why it is called hepatorenal? On the posterior side you will have kidney there. Okay, so for example, this is kidney, so that's why it is called hepatorenal pouch. And anteriorly, the boundaries, okay, let us see boundaries now. Anteriorly, like this, okay, anteriorly it will have inferior surface of right lobe of liver, you can see here. Okay, anteriorly inferior surface of right lobe of liver, and also you'll have gallbladder over here. Okay, and posteriorly it is having right suprarenal gland. As I said, kidney is there, upon kidney you'll have suprarenal gland, right? So you have right side suprarenal gland and also upper part of right kidney, so they are forming its posterior boundaries. And next, also second part of duodenum, you can see here duodenum, especially the duodenum second part is the posterior relation to the hepatorenal pouch, and also the hepatic flexure of colon and transverse mesocolon. So transverse mesocolon is forming a posterior boundary, and also hepatoflexure of colon, and also part of head of pancreas, somewhere over here will be pancreas, right? So head of pancreas is also its posterior relation. And superiorly, the inferior layer of coronary ligament. So why coronary ligament? If you remember, in the liver, here will be the falciform ligament, and it will divide into right triangular ligament, left triangular ligament, and here it will be the coronary ligament. So inferiorly, superiorly will have the inferior layer of coronary ligament, and inferiorly it opens into general peritoneal cavity. That is, this hepatorenal pouch will open into the general peritoneal cavity. Okay, so this is about the relations. So what is the clinical anatomy related to hepatorenal pouch? The clinical anatomy is, this space is of considerable importance as it is most dependent lower part of abdomen proper when the body is supine. So when the person is in supine position, the most dependent part is this hepatorenal pouch. Fluids tend to collect here, and this is common site of subphrenic abscess, okay, and which may be caused by spread of infection from the gallbladder, appendix, or other organs in the region. So as this is near to many organs, we have discussed its boundaries, so it is prone to fluid collection. Okay, so that is its clinical anatomy. What is it? Fluid collection in supine position. So we have also done hepatorenal pouch. Next, we'll discuss about infracolic compartment. So coming to the infracolic compartment, if you see the infracolic compartment, it is divided by mesentery into upper triangular part and lower triangular part, right? So upper triangular, lower triangular part. So actually, the right infracolic compartment lie between the ascending colon and the mesentery, right? Below the transverse mesocolon, exactly here. It is triangular in shape with apex directed downwards. Actually, you know, its apex is directed downward, means not like this, like this. It apex is directed downward. Next, coming to left, this is right side, right? So this is left side, already I mentioned. So this is left infracolic compartment, which is between the descending colon and the mesentery, you can see here. So it is also triangular, whereas its apex is directed upwards. Inferiorly, it opens into pelvis. You can see here, this is a pelvic cavity, right? Pelvic cavity. So inferiorly, it will open into pelvic cavity. Done. So now coming to paracolic gutters. So right and left paracolic gutters. So we also completed infracolic compartment. Now paracolic gutters. So right paracolic gutter open freely into hepatorenal pouch. You can see it's somewhat nearer, right? So it opens directly into hepatorenal pouch at its upper end. It may be infected by a downward spread of infection from hepatorenal pouch or from lesser sac, or by upward spread of appendix. So what they mean? The right paracolic gutter have a chance of infection from hepatorenal pouch or from lesser sac or from appendix. Okay. Next, coming to left paracolic gutter. The left paracolic gutter open freely into pelvis at its lower end because it is nearer to it. Okay. And above, it is separated from spleen and from the linear renal space by phrenicocolic ligament. Actually, here lies the phrenicocolic ligaments and here lies the spleen. Okay, so there is a phrenicocolic ligament between the spleen and the descending colon, or you can say the left paracolic gutter. So it may be infected from supracolic compartment or by upward spread of infection from pelvis. So it may get infected from supracolic or by pelvis. So finally, we have our last part, that is a rectouterine pouch or pouch of Douglas. So for that, we need to draw another diagram. Let us try to fit the diagram over here. Actually, this is urethra. Okay. And actually, understand that this is of a female. Okay. And this is vagina. So what we are drawing now, that is rectouterine pouch, which is present in female. Okay, so this is urethra, this is vagina, and here you have rectouterine pouch, this one RUP. Okay, rectouterine pouch, and this side you'll have your rectum, and this is your rectovaginal fold of peritoneum. Okay, and this is the posterior fornix of vagina. Posterior fornix of vagina. It's written here, vagina. Okay, so now let us understand this. Actually, this is also called pouch of Douglas. It is most dependent part of peritoneal cavity, especially in upright position in a female. Actually, why most dependent part? Because most of the fluid may have a chance to get filled in this cavity, especially in female. So what are its boundaries? Clearly you can see, and this is the pouch, right? Exact location we are concerned about. So anteriorly, if you see, you have uterus, right? This is the uterus. Sorry, this is not urethra, this is uterus, sorry, correct it. So anteriorly you have uterus, and also you have the posterior fornix of vagina, and posteriorly you have the rectum, and inferiorly you have the rectovaginal fold of peritoneum. This is the rectovaginal fold of peritoneum. So these are the boundaries of rectouterine pouch. So what is the clinical anatomy? The floor of the pouch from the anus can be easily left with a finger passed through the rectum or vagina, and corresponding rectovesical pouch in male is 7.5. So in the case of female, if you see this rectovesical pouch, not rectouterine pouch, we are talking about rectovesical pouch. Rectovesical pouch in female is 5.5 centimeters, whereas in male it is 7.5 centimeters above anus. Okay. And it's coming to being the most dependent part of peritoneal cavity. Pus also tend to collect over here, okay? And the pouch can be drained either through rectum or through posterior fornix of vagina. So either by posterior fornix of vagina or by rectum, we try to drain this fluid out of it. So by this, we have completed all the pouches of this, all the spaces of this special region of peritoneal cavity. Next, we'll start with peritoneal fossa or पेरिटोनियल रिसेस।